Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Learning Electronics. In this lecture, we are going to study a new topic which is parallel inverter with feedback diodes. In the last class, we have studied basic parallel inverter. So if you want to see that video, you can check it in the channel playlist. So before starting this video, I will request you to please subscribe my channel and also press the bell icon so that you can get more updated videos from here. This is the circuit diagram of parallel inverter with feedback diodes. Here we are using two diodes D1 and D2 which are called as feedback diodes. Therefore, this circuit is called as parallel inverter with feedback diodes. In this circuit, you can see we are using a center tap transformer as we have used in the basic parallel inverter also. So, as we are using a center tap transformer in this inverter is also called as center tapped inverter. Here again we are using two SCRs S1 and S2 as we have used in the basic parallel inverter. These SCRs S1 and S2 are switched alternatively to connect the DC supply across the two halves of the transformer. The commutation which we are using in this parallel inverter is voltage commutation. Here you can see we have two components connected here, L1 and C. This L1 and C are called as commutating components which are used to commutate this S1 and S2 SCR individually. Here D1 and D2 diodes are feedback diodes. They are used for two purposes. First, to feedback the load reactive power to the supply, and second, to feedback the stored energy across this L1 inductor and capacitor C to the load. Here we are using RL load. In the previous class in which we have studied the parallel inverter, there we are used only the resistive load. So in the parallel inverter with feedback diodes, we are using the RL load here. Now we'll understand the working of this parallel inverter with feedback diodes. The operation of this circuit is divided into four modes of operation, mode number 1, 2, 3 and 4. First we will consider mode number 1 operation. This mode number 1 operation starts at time t is equal to t1. At time t is equal to t1, only S1 SCR is fired and S2 SCR will remain in the off condition, so it will act as open circuit. So as soon as this S1 SCR goes into the on condition, this is the circuit diagram, the D1 and D2 diode will also be in the off condition only. So this is the final circuit diagram when only S1 SCR is conducting. So as soon as this S1 SCR starts conducting, this input voltage VS will come across the OA part of the primary winding. Therefore, we will get VOA is equal to VS. So here the voltage will be equal to VS. Now by the transformer action, the voltage across the BO part of the primary winding, that is VBO, will also be equal to VS. Okay, so the total voltage across this primary winding VAB will be equal to 2VS we will get. As soon as this S1 SCR starts conducting, the capacitor connected in the circuit starts charging, and the maximum voltage with which it can charge is equal to 2VS because this primary winding is connected in parallel with this capacitor. Therefore, the maximum voltage across the capacitor is equal to 2 into VS. Now, due to the transformer action, in the last class we have derived the expression for the output voltage of parallel inverter. So according to that derivation, the output voltage will be equal to K into VS, where K is equal to turns ratio N2 by N1 here. So this is the equation of the output voltage for the parallel inverter with feedback diodes. As soon as this S1 SCR starts conducting, source current starts flowing in the circuit, and this source current will enter at this O point. So this O point will be positive with respect to this A point. So when we are taking this B point will be positive with respect to this O point again because of the transformer action. So overall this B point will be positive with respect to A point in the first mode of operation. Therefore, output voltage polarity will be positive on this point and negative on this point. So whatever be the load current flowing in this circuit like this, the load current and load voltage will be taken as positive in the first mode of operation. When this capacitor is fully charged with voltage is equal to plus 2 VS, Here you can see this positive on the right hand plate of this capacitor is coming towards the P side of this H2SCR. So this H2SCR will go into the forward bias condition and ready to turn on. So when we trigger this H2SCR at time T is equal to T2, what happens? As soon as this H2SCR goes into the on condition, the voltage across the capacitor will come across this S1SCR. So here you can see this voltage across the capacitor is reverse bias voltage for this S1SCR, because this negative polarity on the left hand side plate is coming towards the P side of this S1SCR. So this S1SCR will go into the reverse bias condition when this S2SCR starts conducting. So when S1SCR goes into the off condition, this will be the circuit diagram. At time T is equal to T2, our mode 2 operation starts. The mode 2 operation starts when S2SCR starts conducting, and as soon as this S2SCR starts conducting, this D1 diode also starts conducting. Now the capacitor will get the path for discharging. Therefore, the capacitor which was charged in the mode number 1 operation with voltage is equal to 2Vs now will discharge through the path consisting of S2SCR, L1 inductor, D1 diode and primary winding part PA. This is primary winding part PA through which this capacitor is discharging. That means the energy stored in the capacitor is fed back to the load in this mode of operation, whereas in the mode number 1 operation, energy is supplied by the supply to the load. Whereas in the mode 2 operation, the stored energy in the capacitor is supplied to the load. Here you can see as soon as this D1 starts conducting, the P point of this primary winding will be held at the negative potential of the input DC voltage. Therefore, the source current which starts flowing in this primary winding will flow from O point to P point. This will be the direction of the source current in the second mode of operation. So in this second mode of operation, capacitor supply power to PA part of the primary winding during discharge period, and this power is transformed and supplied to this RL load here. So here let us consider the polarity of the output voltage. As this source current is entering at this point and this point is negative, so A point will be positive with respect to B point here. That means here at the load, the polarity of the output voltage will be minus on this point and positive on this point. Okay, that means the output voltage will be reversed in polarity and the output voltage will be greater than the source voltage in this second mode of operation, because here stored energy is transferred to the load. Next mode of operation is mode 3 operation, which starts at time T is equal to T3. As we have discussed in the mode 2 operation, this capacitor is discharging in the mode 2 operation. So after some time, what happens? The discharging current reduces, and this discharging current reduces below the source current. That means the capacitor discharging current will become less than the source current. And as we have discussed in the mode 2 operation, the D1 diode gone into the on condition because of the capacitor discharging current, and when the capacitor discharging current becomes less than the source current, what happens? The D1 diode goes into the off condition. When this capacitor is discharging, at that time this L1 inductor starts storing the energy. Therefore, due to the energy stored in this inductor L1, this D2 diode will go into the on condition, because the voltage across this inductor L1 will be plus on this point and minus on this point. So this D2 diode will go into the on condition in mode 3 operation. So H2SCR is already in the conducting mode, but in the mode 3 operation, D2 diode will go into the on condition. S1SCR and D1 diode will be in the off condition in the mode 3 operation. Now the current flows from D2 diode to QB part of the primary winding, then it will go to H2SCR, then it will go to L1 inductor, and it will end at the negative terminal of this voltage source. Okay, so this is the path of the current during the third mode of operation. We know that the inductor is also an energy storing device. So in the mode number 1 operation, when capacitor supplies power to this load, this inductor will store the energy. So when this inductor will store the energy, it will impart its energy in the mode 3 operation to the source. So in the mode 3 operation, the load imparts the energy to the source, or you can say the load reactive energy is returned to the DC source in the mode 3 operation, and the source current now flows through Q to O point like this. Source current direction is reversed in the third mode of operation because this RL load is supplying power to the input supply here. Now, as load is supplying power to the supply, this capacitor again starts charging with reverse polarity. That means plus on this left hand side plate and minus on this right hand side plate, and this capacitor will be charged slightly greater than 2 Vs voltage of reverse polarity, as you can see here. And here the Q point will be held at negative potential as soon as this D2 diode go into the on condition. So the output polarity will also be reversed in this mode of operation. Now, when all the energy in the L1 inductor is fed back to the load in this third mode of operation, S2SCR turns off by the natural commutation. So, at the end of this mode 3 operation, S2SCR will go into the off condition. Last mode of operation is mode 4 operation. It starts at time t is equal to T4 when the load current goes to 0. Indicating that all the reactive power stored in this RL load returned back to the source completely. This S2SCR, which gone into the off condition, re-triggered again. Okay, so when this S2SCR go into the on condition, all the other device will remain in the off condition, that is D1 diode, D2 diode and S1SCR will be in the off condition in the fourth mode of operation. So only S2SCR will be in the conducting mode. So in this state, what happens? The output voltage will again be equal to K into Vs, as we have studied in the mode number 1 operation. But in this, the load current becomes negative. So as soon as this S1SCR starts conducting, the source current will enter at this O point and it will flow through this OB part of the primary winding. So this B point becomes negative and this A point becomes positive here. So the load voltage polarity will be negative on this point, positive on this point. So the output voltage will be equal to K into Vs and the load current will be taken as negative in this mode of operation. And S1SCR is again fired to turn off this S2SCR and cycle repeats like this. Now we will understand the output waveforms of the parallel inverter with feedback diodes. Here you can see we are applying a train of pulses to ensure the turn on of the SCRs. So first mode of operation starts from time t is equal to t1 and it ends at time t is equal to t2. In this modes of operation, the source will supply the power to the load and the output voltage will be equal to K into Vs in this mode of operation. Second mode of operation starts at time t is equal to t2 and ends at time t is equal to t3. In this mode of operation, the load voltage will be greater than the source voltage by a small value. Okay, and this voltage will be taken as positive. So the output voltage in the second mode of operation will be greater than K into Vs here. And in this mode of operation, as we have studied, the energy stored in the commutating components will be fed back to the load. Then third mode of operation starts at time t is equal to t3 and it goes up to time t is equal to t4. And in this mode of operation, the reactive energy stored in the RL load will be fed back to the source. Output voltage will be greater than this K into Vs voltage by a small value. So we are taking this type of waveform here. Now fourth mode of operation starts at time t is equal to t4. In this fourth mode of operation, S2SCR is re-triggered. So in this mode of operation, again the source will provide the power to the load and the output voltage will be equal to K into Vs in this mode of operation. So these are the four modes of operation. This is the fundamental load voltage waveform for this parallel inverter, and this is the actual waveform of the parallel inverter with feedback diodes. And since we are using a RL load, therefore the load voltage and load current will be out of phase in the parallel inverter. Therefore here we are getting this type of waveform. Since we are using inductive load, we are getting the load current waveform like this. So as we have studied, during the first mode of operation, S1SCR is triggered. During second mode of operation, S2 SCR and D1 diode goes into the on condition. During third mode of operation, only D2 diode goes into the on condition and S2 SCR will continue to conduct. In the fourth mode of operation, only S2 SCR will start conducting. So these are the waveforms of the parallel inverter with feedback diodes. Now we will understand some of the merits and demerits of this parallel inverter with feedback diodes. First is, output voltage does not depend on load, as we have studied in the series inverter. In series inverter, output voltage depends on the load and load parameters. As we have seen in the parallel inverter that it is a simple and economical circuit. The output which we are getting, it is a type of square wave or rectangular type of waveform. So with filter at the output, it is possible to get a good quality sine wave in the parallel inverter. The commutation components don't have to carry the entire load current in the parallel inverter, and with the help of feedback diodes, the load reactive power is fed back to the source to improve the efficiency of the circuit. And the frequency of the output voltage is independent of the load, but it depends on the triggering frequency of the thyristor in the parallel inverter. So these are the parallel inverter merits. Now we will study the demerits. As you can see in the circuit diagram, it uses a center tap transformer. Therefore, the efficiency of the inverter is reduced because this transformer is not 100% efficient. Second is, possibility of magnetic saturation of the core will exist at low frequencies. Third, circuit is suitable to handle only fixed load. Fourth is, inductive load used in the parallel inverter may reduce the commutation angle to such a low limit that the circuit may become oscillatory and commutation failure may occur. Fifth point is that transient oscillation cause serious stresses in the thyristors in this parallel inverter. And last is, the switching transients are superimposed on the output voltage. Therefore, we will get distorted output voltage in the parallel inverter. So, hope you have understood the topic. Thank you very much for watching and please do subscribe my channel for more updates.